Hello all, this is Dr. Alsop, and in this video we will be discussing the meninges, and in particular the cranial meninges, as there are some distinct differences, particularly in the dura, to the spinal meninges. So let's get started. So the major learning objectives covered in this video include a review of the three types of meninges, with a focus on the difference between the cranial and the spinal, specifically dura mater. And we will spend the last portion of this video discussing the dural partitions or infoldings, so what they are and where they're located. All right, recall that the meninges are membranous coverings of the central nervous system. So this will include both the brain as well as the spinal cord. So a lot of the images or the illustrations we have are going to be of the spinal cord because sometimes it's easier to conceptualize there, even though the focus of this particular video will be on the meninges of the brain. The major function of the meninges is to protect and support both the brain and the spinal cord, but also it's important to note that the meninges will form a supporting framework for dural venous sinuses, veins, and arteries, in addition to enclosing that fluid-filled subarachnoid space, which is really vital to normal CNS function. There are three meninges. There will be the tough or thick external fibrous layer, or the dura mater, the thin intermediate layer, which is going to be the arachnoid mater, and then the thin but delicate internal vascularized layer, which is the pia mater, so kind of going from superficial to deep. The arachnoid and the pia mater are actually continuous, and when discussing together, you often hear the term leptomeninx when you're talking about the arachnoid and the pia. The dura mater is the first thing one sees when performing a craniotomy, so if you remove the calvaria before you even see the brain, you'd be looking at the dura mater. But it really is going to be all over the place when we're discussing the internal portions of the cranium. As mentioned, the dura mater in the skull is unique, as there are two layers associated with the cranial meninges, instead of just the one dura mater layer associated with the spinal cord. There is the periosteal, sometimes you'll hear it referred to as the endosteal layer. You'll hear it either way. This is the outermost or most superficial layer, and this is what's going to line the cranial cavity, and you can see a bit of this has been kind of pulled away from the bone here, and so this will be the periosteal dura. The meningeal layer is the inner dural layer, and it's typically closely applied to both the periosteal dura mater and the arachnoid mater. In fact, the periosteal and meningeal layers are most often closely adhered to one another, except for in a few specific but important areas, and you can see the meningeal dura kind of reflecting away from the periosteal dura right here. And so you can see that's creating this space right here, which will actually be a dural venous sinus during life, and it can continue to create these areas called dural partitions, and that will be the specializations of meningeal dura. As mentioned above, the arachnoid and the pia mater are often discussed together. The arachnoid mater loosely translates to spidery mother. This is named so because of these trabeculae that will kind of extend through the subarachnoid space. These trabeculae are composed of flattened, irregularly shaped fibroblasts that are going to bridge the subarachnoid space. Now, the arachnoid is thin, but it can be manipulated with forceps. So the forceps in this particular image are pulling the dura, but you can move the arachnoid mater, certainly more so than the pia mater. Arachnoid, although closely applied to the meningeal layer of dura mater, is not directly attached to the dura. Instead, it's held against the inner surface of the dura by the pressure of the cerebrospinal fluid, or the CSF, in the subarachnoid space. The pia mater is even thinner than the arachnoid mater, and it's very difficult to kind of see or define as a layer on a gross level, but it's what gives the brain and the spinal cord that shiny appearance. So it's kind of right on top of the brain and the spinal cord. It is highly vascularized by a network of fine blood vessels and will adhere to the surface of the brain and follow all of its contours. For example, when the cerebral arteries penetrate the cerebral cortex, the pia will actually follow along the artery for a short distance. So it's really closely adhered to those dips into the fissures and the sulci. Now, that space between the arachnoid and the pia mater that have these arachnoid trabeculae spanning throughout is called the subarachnoid space. So the subarachnoid space will house the cerebral spinal fluid, which we will talk about in more detail in the ventricles video, but it'll also have vasculature that's going to travel within the space, so a very important area. Note, and this is an important note, the subarachnoid space is a real space. So it has things in it during life. It's an actual space during life. It is not a potential space. And we will be discussing some potential spaces in subsequent videos, like the subdural or epidural spaces, that these do not typically exist in normal, healthy adults, but can form as a space if infection or blood enters the area due to infection or injury. So the subarachnoid space is a true space. It is not a potential space. In certain areas, portions of the arachnoid will kind of fold up and project into dural venous sinuses, which form between the periosteal meningeal dura in certain areas. Because they project into these sinuses and their associated lateral projections called lacunae, they are able to drain CSF into the venous sinuses when drainage needs to occur. This is particularly evident with the superior sagittal sinus, but can occur in other dural venous sinuses. These granulations will cause the bone around it to erode or pit, and you can see some of these in this particular donor right here, and these areas on the bone are called granular foveolae. Returning to the cranial dura mater, in certain areas that meningeal layer will reflect away from the periosteal dura, creating these specializations of the meningeal dura, referred to as dural infoldings. I often like to refer to them as dural partitions. These dural partitions often house dural venous sinuses, which we'll talk about a great bit more detail in the dural venous sinus lecture. These partitions or dural septa between certain parts of the brain will really help to support certain areas. All right, so there are four dural partitions. The fulc cerebri, which you can see here, is the largest. It will be located in that longitudinal cerebral fissure between the cerebral hemispheres during life. The brain has obviously been removed in this dissection. This fulc cerebri has a very distinct sickle shape and extends from the crista galli anteriorly all the way towards the internal occipital protuberance on the posterior portion. In both the superior sagittal sinus and the inferior sagittal sinus will be associated with the fulc cerebri. The tentorium cerebelli is the second largest partition and will separate the cerebrum, specifically that occipital lobe of the cerebrum, and the cerebellum. And you can see that over here. This is part of the tentorium cerebelli, and you can really see its expanse on this particular image. This whole area right here and right here will be part of the tentorium cerebelli. This partition will attach to the clinoid processes of the sphenoid. It will extend back towards the petrous parts of the temporal bone, which would be here and here, and it will also extend to the parts of the internal surface of the occipital bone, so a fairly large expanse. It will also create this region right here called the tentorial notch, and the midbrain will sit right here during life. And it will also serve to separate the tentorium cerebelli from the diaphragmatic cellae, which is going to be right around this region. Okay, the last two dural partitions. And in this particular image, the tentorium cerebelli has been removed to get a slight glimpse of the fox cerebelli, which is right in this region right here. This partition is quite small, and during life is located between the cerebellar hemispheres. This also has an attachment on the internal occipital protuberance, similar to that fox cerebri, but it will extend inferiorly, and the occipital sinus will be associated with the fox cerebelli. The fourth and last dural partition is the diaphragm ocelli, and this is going to form a roof over the hypophyseal fossa. So you can see a bit of it right here and right here-ish. But it's going to have an aperture for passage of the infundibulum, and you can actually see a bit of the infundibulum right here, which is often referred to as the pituitary stalk, as well as allow for hypophyseal veins to kind of move in this region. So a fairly small circular horizontal sheet over this area. But you can see it's a little bit more difficult to see than some of the other dural partitions. So that is the cranial meninges and dural partitions. Let's take a minute to review. All right, what do you think about this question? Which portion of the meninges will form the dural partitions? Is it the arachnoid mater? Is it the meningeal dura mater? Is it C, periosteal dura mater? Or D, pia mater? Take a moment, pause the video if you need to, try to answer this without going back through your notes. And once you are ready, let's discuss how B, or that meningeal dura mater, is the correct answer. It is the meningeal dura mater that reflects away from its close adherence to the periosteal dura mater to form the dural infoldings or partitions. The periosteal dura mater is the part that's is very closely adhered to the bone, and so it is the deeper meningeal dura mater that will reflect away. The arachnoid and the pia mater are not involved in the dural partitions, as its name would suggest, so those two are not the correct answer. All right, so that wraps us up in regards to the meninges and the dural partitions. We will return to some of these concepts when discussing the dural venous sinuses, as well as the discussion of the cerebrospinal fluid in the ventricles video. Thank you so much for your attention, and as always, please do feel free to reach out with any questions.